You're listening to the audio production of Shelter in God, Your Refuge in Times of Trouble by Dr. David Jeremiah, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Henry O. Arnold.
Introduction. Where can we go during times of trouble? One answer is Zahara de la Sierra in the Cadiz province of southern Spain. Originally built as a castle and fortress in the Andalusian mountains, Zahara has endured as a place of refuge and security for nearly 1,000 years. The town was founded as an outpost for the Moors of the Maghrib. Its location between the cities of Ronda and Seville was critical for military strategy. While armies crisscrossed Spain during the Middle Ages, Zahara stood strong against both soldiers and siege. Opposing forces could not escape the all-seeing watchman on the top of Zahara's walls, and any attempted incursion involved a steep and harrowing climb long before any battle was joined. The castle was eventually captured in 1483 by forces under the command of the Duke of Cadiz, but not without great effort and great loss of life. Today, Zahara de la Sierra is a picturesque village of whitewashed houses, famously known as Pueblos Blancos. Tourists flock to the town for breathtaking views of the surrounding mountains and the clear, turquoise waters of the Zahara El Gastor Reservoir, not to mention the scintillating smell of the orange blossoms from the surrounding countryside. Instead of soldiers and watchmen, visitors today find friendly locals eager to share their stories and their traditional Spanish cuisine. In March of 2020, however, it became obvious to Zahara's 40-year-old mayor, Santiago Galvan, that a new enemy was creeping across the Spanish countryside, extending its tentacles through the Cadiz and seeking to make its way up the mountains toward his town. This enemy's forces had already paralyzed great empires and threatened more devastation worldwide. The enemy had many names, but the ones used by most Zaharans as they whispered together in their mountain homes was COVID-19, or, more commonly, the coronavirus. On March 14th, Galvan used his authority as mayor to shut the gates of Zahara. The entire town was closed, its only road in or out blocked and barricaded. All 1,400 residents were ordered to remain in their homes for an indefinite period of time, and no outsiders were permitted entry. The entire village was effectively quarantined not only from the virus, but also from the outside world. The townspeople fully supported the mayor's drastic steps. In fact, they joined together in an effort to keep their fortress secure. Two workers took up a car washing station along the town's main street, using equipment typically reserved for washing olive trees, in order to sanitize the vehicles of any residents who needed to venture out. Every Monday and Thursday at 5:30 in the evening, a group of 10 citizens donned protective gear and stepped outside to disinfect the streets. Other volunteers made sure the elderly had enough food and could request home repairs when necessary. As I write this, the town's efforts seem to be working, even as the broader community in Spain has been hit hard. There have been more than 170,000 coronavirus cases in Spain. Tragically, more than 18,000 of those cases have resulted in death, the third highest total among all the countries in the world. Yet, not a single person within the borders of Zahara has been affected. Speaking by phone, Mayor Galvan expressed pride in the spirit of his townspeople, as well as Zahara's status as a strong refuge. "We have managed to give tranquility to our neighbors," he said. "They know no one unknown can come in." There are many who wish they could face the coronavirus's continued encroachment with the confidence of Mayor Galvan and the people of Zahara. I wish the same were true of me. I would give much to move my family and my congregation to some isolated mountain peak so we could weather this troubling storm together. Alas, I have no such assurances against this particular manifestation of the unknown. I must face it rather than hide from it, and I'm sure the same is true for you. Personally, I have encountered many sobering seasons throughout my lifetime. I've seen wars begin and end. I've witnessed religious persecution break out in totalitarian regimes with surprising speed and violence. I was among those who watched the news each night, breathless with tension, during the Cuban Missile Crisis at the height of the Cold War. I have lived through the entire HIV/AIDS epidemic, which began when I was a young pastor in the 1980s, and I can still remember watching helplessly as United Airlines Flight 175 crashed into the South Tower of the World Trade Center on September 11, 2001. But I can't say I've seen anything quite like the coronavirus pandemic that is currently squeezing every nation in its quick and deadly grip. At the time of this writing, more than 2 million people have been diagnosed with COVID-19. More than 125,000 have died from the disease. Because of the speed and virulence of the coronavirus, more than half the people on this planet are sheltering in place, under government-mandated instructions not to leave their homes for any non-essential activity. The world has been locked down. To make matters worse, the virus's rapid spread has isolated people from the communities they typically turn to in times of tension and fear. Churches have been forced to close their doors. Restaurants are still making meals, but only for delivery. Movie theaters, bowling alleys, and most retail stores are out of operation. And in a move that feels especially surreal to me as a California resident, Disneyland closed its doors to the public on March 14th, something that has happened only 3 times in its 65-year history. Right now, the questions weighing down my mind and heart are the same questions burdening people all over the world, including even those sheltered residents of Zahara. Why is all this happening? Do I have what it takes to get my family through? When will everything go back to normal as a nation, as a church? And perhaps the most pressing question of all, where is God in the midst of these difficult times? Such questions are not unique to the coronavirus, nor are they limited to global pandemics. These are the questions we grapple with whenever disaster falls upon us, especially when disaster strikes seemingly without warning. Frankly, I don't know the answers to the first 4 questions I mentioned earlier. Outside of the conspiracy theories, no one can say why the virus is here. I'm anxious to lead my family during this time, but as a man in my 70s, I feel personally threatened by the coronavirus in a way I haven't experienced since my recovery from cancer. And as much as I hope life will return to normal in a matter of weeks, I see little hope for that reality on the horizon. Thankfully, I do know the answer to that final question, and it brings me peace when all other answers fail. Where is God during these difficult times? He's right here, right next to me, and right next to you, the same place He always has been and always will be. You and I may not have access to a mountain fortress such as Zahara de la Sierra, but we can find refuge from the threat of any disaster, including coronavirus, when we turn to God and seek His presence. That's because God is with us. He is supporting us. He is equipping us and empowering us with everything we need to endure not only this disaster, but any situation or circumstance we may face. That's why I have been so eager to prepare this book. Because even as I am sheltering in place, I'm also sheltering in God. I'm allowing myself to be surrounded by His presence and power and peace. I want the same for you. I want the same for anyone who feels frightened and abandoned and uncertain about the future. In the following pages, we'll look at several key examples from the book of Psalms in order to discover comfort, inspiration, and hope as we deal with the unknown of this moment and any other season of suffering. Most of the Psalms we will explore together were written by David, a man who was well acquainted with trials and tragedies of all kinds. Even so, he was still able to write these words, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. Psalm 18, verse 2. Through David's example, you will learn that there is hope for you even in the darkest of nights. Why? Because God is your shelter, and He will not fail. Psalm 121, a song of ascents. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither sleep nor slumber. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in, from this time forth and even forevermore. Chapter 1. Lord, Help! Lane McKeel, a senior adult, ventured out of his house during the coronavirus pandemic to get a few supplies at his local grocery store in Georgetown, Tennessee. He'd been shut in for some time, but his disability check had arrived, and he needed some food and staples. When he reached the checkout counter, his bill was $173. As he counted out his money, he was surprised to find himself $33 short. Maybe you've had a similar experience. It's an embarrassing moment. McKeel quickly began grabbing things to put back on the shelf, but the 17-year-old cashier stopped him. Her name was Iconic, Elizabeth Taylor. Reaching for her purse, the teenager paid McKeel's total bill out of her own money. When someone asked her why she did it, Taylor said, "It was all essential stuff. We've seen a lot of older people, and they're all trying to buy groceries, and a lot of places have run out of stuff, and so the older people are kind of taking the downfall for that. I just try to give back when I can." Life often catches us short. It's embarrassing to find ourselves needing help, but we all need all the help we can get, especially in times of crisis. We all need grace, grace that's more than sufficient. So many of the Psalms are written for pilgrims needing help on the path of life. As we read Psalm 121, we can hear the psalmist crying out, "Lord, I need supplies for my journey. I need help. I need guidance. I've lost my way. Can't you show me the right way to go? Can't you meet my needs?" In this beautiful psalm of just 8 verses, we're encouraged to trust God even when life gives us what we haven't asked for. The confidence expressed in Psalm 121 is rooted in the grandeur of the psalmist's vision of God, the maker of heaven and earth, the Lord who can be trusted to help us at every point along the journey, through the sunny passages as well as the darker treks through forests of night. The psalmist lifts his eyes to the hills above and sees the one who is not only the destination of the journey, but also the strength for every step of it. In spite of all the perils we encounter, the mountainous crags and the desert wastelands, we can trust the Lord. Yes, He is awesome, and we feel small and insignificant, but the psalmist assures us that God bridges the gap. He is never too great to care. We are never too small for His caring. The psalm reflects on a God who soothes us in our anxiety and watches over us as a shepherd with His sheep. As you hold your Bible open to this wonderful chapter, you will find these important words in superscription, a song of ascents. What does that mean? There are 15 of these special psalms, the first of them being Psalm 120. In those ancient days, the Israelites would travel to Jerusalem for feast days at the temple. Coming from whatever distant town they called home, the pilgrims would make the long journey by foot, walking with their families and friends and enjoying their holiday travel. They were eager for good times in the holy city, seeing friends again over the feast and making sacrifices to God. Scholars believe the Songs of Ascents were written to be sung along the road from the lowlands of Palestine up to Jerusalem. As the travelers walked up that natural incline.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.